the worst terror attack on Britons abroad since 9/11. 30 British dead, 26 injured.
People who were lying on sun loungers. He was just murdering them.
A holiday paradise, now off limits to British tourists. Lives changed forever by a gunman in black.
To see fellow holidaymakers in a swimwear, laying dead in pools of blood, you just can never, ever imagine that ever happening to you.
Should holidaymakers have known more about the dangers posed by jihadis?
By not listening to their messages, we paid the price heavily.
It's eerie and unsettling to walk through these marble halls where so many people died, and to know that amongst the stories of human suffering and heroism, there are still so many unanswered questions.
Tonight on Panorama, the survivors of the horror in Tunisia tell their story.
I was looking straight at him and he was looking at me.
Not knowing if I was going home or if I was going to be coming back in a body bag. It was just horrific.
We piece together footage of the attack as it happened. We speak to crucial eyewitnesses about the failure of the Tunisian authorities.
The policeman refused to shoot, saying he wanted to wait as he had no orders to fire and had no bulletproof vest.
And we ask, were warnings ignored that could have saved British lives? Friday, June the 26th, started like any other day for thousands of holidaymakers at Sousse on the shores of the Mediterranean. People came down to the beach. The sun loungers filled up. Friends and families look forward to relaxing at the five-star Tunisian resort. Angela Evans from Norfolk was there that morning with her friend. They'd arrived the day before.
I've been going on holiday to Tunisia for, 15 to 20 years. I like the people.
People like Mehdi Jamelt and Mohamed Mokhtar, the beach boys running the water sports activities. Mehdi has made a living from Sousse Beach for the last 6 years. He was looking forward to the summer season.
We sat talking about life, about the weather, and how long the season would last.
For 24-year-old Mohamed, this was a dream job. He loved helping British tourists.
I was talking with the English woman. It was a lovely day. It's like every day.
That Englishwoman was Becky Catterick from Scunthorpe, on holiday with her boyfriend Mark Barlow.
We went paragliding when we got down there. Mark went first and then I went after him.
Becky filmed Mehdi, helping Mark take off.
Just in the air, looking at everything like this is mint. Sun was shining, we were just happy to be there.
From above, you can see the two hotels which border this part of the beach. The Imperial, and next door, the Bellevue. They both have large swimming pools and gardens. At 11:38 that morning, everything changed. A man in black carrying a parasol came walking along the beach. Ellie Makin, a tennis coach from Yorkshire, was one of the first to notice him.
I looked to the right-hand side of me, saw all the holidaymakers looking as casual as anything. Then I saw this gunman. He dropped the parasol. He brought out this massive, like, black gun, and he just then started shooting everybody.
Mohammed saw the first victim, a woman, die.
She was looking to him, and he shot her. He killed her. And then he starts shooting everyone in the beach. He doesn't care.
He was just systematically going from side to side. Just shooting people, just killing them.
The gunman was armed with a Kalashnikov, a powerful assault rifle.
There's no words to describe how quick it happened. It was literally split second, and then we just ran, literally just ran for my life.
Angela and her friend had no time to run.
We looked at each other and said, just play dead. We just got to play dead. We just threw ourselves to the ground, put our heads right in the sand.
Mark and Becky were in a beach shack, choosing paragliding photos when the shooting began.
Everyone started running and shouting and, you know, screaming, really.
We didn't know what was going on. We just hit the ground. The locals told us to just stay down, stay in there, stay down. So we did do.
Within minutes of the shooting starting, the Beach Boys made an emergency call to the Coast Guard, who they knew carried guns. Waiting for them to arrive, Mehdi couldn't believe what he was seeing.
There was so much blood on the beach. I had never in my life seen so much blood and so many people dying like that.
Tunisians on the beach quickly realized the gunman wasn't targeting them. All he wanted to do was kill foreign tourists. They pleaded with him to stop.
You say, please stop shooting. He doesn't listen to us. He just keeps shooting.
The gunman continued firing for 2 whole minutes. Then there was silence.
And there was no more screaming. There's no screaming in front of me. And he was at the side of me. And I was laying down and I could see his feet.
The gunman reloaded, while Angela played dead in the sand right next to him.
And there was like a click. And something dropped. I suppose, I guessed, he'd run out of ammunition, but he'd refilled and he was above me. And at that time, you just know you're gonna die in a minute.
Then something distracted the gunman. He turned away.
I don't know what it was, but you know, it was enough for him to turn, and I knew he turned because all the sand had come up on me.
The gunman left Angela alive, but at least 18 people were dead around her. He moved up from the beach and walked through an open gate into the grounds of the Imperial Hotel, towards the pool and more British tourists. One of them was Sam Richards, an NHS manager from Cheshire, on holiday with her sons, Tom, and 16-year-old Callum.
Callum, being a teenager, didn't want to get up, so myself and Thomas sat around the pool and read a book.
I was switching between reading a book and listening to music. Just sunbathing, really, trying to catch the rays.
Tony and Christine Callahan from Norfolk were on the other side of the pool. They'd been to the hotel twice before.
You tend to get to your sunbeds a little bit early, just so you sort of get where the area that we typically want.
Beautiful. It was really hot, and I was swimming in the pool, in and out, keep cool. It was really nice.
The calm at the pool was shattered by the noise from the beach.
I had a good idea that they were gunshots. And a lot of people stopped still around us and looked up, and it was like a deathly quiet, like it was horrible, eerie feel.
Tony Callahan, who'd been in the military, knew something was terribly wrong.
I know from my time in the Royal Air Force that, you know, and I've fired many automatic weapons myself, that that was sustained gunfire.
As the gunmen headed their way, Tony took charge of the situation.
So I started shouting at the top of my voice for people to please run. We're under attack. That is gunfire. We're being shot at. So please, please run. Take, you know, take cover. Get to some safety.
It happened again, more gunfire. And that's when I turned to my mum and said, run.
So we got up, picked our belongings up, don't know why, and just ran from where we were and just kept running and running and running.
Along with many other people, got our way into the hotel as fast as we could, and my heart was beating so fast, I was trembling.
As they fled, they could hear the shooting behind them. Tunisians, realizing they weren't the gunman's target, had followed him. Among them, Issam Bayzi, a cigarette seller.
He was shooting at the pool from a distance as people were running towards it. He had a grenade which he threw by the pool.
Sam and Tom were by now at the entrance to the hotel.
He was behind us. We could hear him shooting. Yeah, it was getting louder as well. I just didn't look back. I just ran up towards the hotel, up the steps.
Tony knew he was in danger.
I heard then bullets whizzing by, and you can hear it's a very distinct sort of sound when a bullet whizzes by. And I thought, well, it's time I got out of there then.
He got to the hotel to find Christine in the lobby.
It was absolutely chaotic, and you were running for your lives. It was chaotic. It was horrendous to go through.
Further down the beach, Ayman Dahassin, a Tunisian on holiday, ran towards the gunfire.
When we heard the sound of heavy shooting, we wanted to know what was happening on the beach. We were about 200 metres away.
Ayman started to film with his phone. The 29-year-old chef would go on to capture remarkable and shocking footage of the attack and the gunman.
I was afraid when he was shooting, but I followed him and filmed him. I felt I had to film him. I didn't care if I was killed.
The beach boys say it took 12 minutes before one coast guard and a policeman arrived in a boat. The policeman had an assault rifle, but didn't seem keen to tackle the gunman.
We called him and told him to shoot the terrorist, but he refused to shoot, saying he wanted to wait as he had no order to fire and no bulletproof vest.
The beach boys say he even tried to disguise himself.
If he see me with a t-shirt of police, he will shoot me. So he rolled the t-shirt in his hand and he get run with the people.
So he took the t-shirt off so the gunman would think he was a tourist?
Yeah. He think he's a Tunisian. The police, they were scared.
Before he left, the policeman handed over his assault rifle.
Someone said to the policeman, I have army training. I can go inside with you if you are afraid. The policeman refused. People surrounded him and he tried to get away. But the lad with army training took the gun and went into the hotel grounds.
This young man would later find himself confronting the killer, exposing the woeful response of the Tunisian security services. The gunman is still in the grounds of the Imperial Hotel. On the beach, Angela and her friend dare to move again.
I just said, look, we gotta go, we gotta go. And I knew there was the hotel next door. So we just both started running, but I couldn't run very far and I ended up crawling a lot of the way. But I can never explain the... Don't think I'll ever be able to explain that. Fear isn't a big enough word.
while Angela made her way to the Bellevue Hotel. Ellie, the tennis coach, had already made it to the lobby there.
That woman's husband got shot in the stomach. So nobody's telling us anything what we're meant to be doing right now.
Ellie filmed the confusion, trying to find out what was going on.
He's not coming here. This guy was right next to us.
Yeah, next to us. Happened something bad, but it's okay now.
Are you okay?
Yes.
I asked the staff, had they rang the police? Had they done anything about it? Was the security aware? And they said they don't know what's going on.
Ellie hid in a bedroom, afraid she might be next.
I was texting my parents just saying, I love you all so much, and this is probably going to be the end, you know.
Yeah, black top on, massive gun, bit like brown hair.
Not knowing if I was going home or if I was going to be coming back in a body bag, it was just horrific.
The owner of the Imperial Hotel was one of the first to find out about the attack. She's an MP with a direct line to the Tunisian government.
At the time of the attack, I was on my way to this hotel, and I got the call to say the attack had started. I was distraught. I thought immediately of my clients and staff. My first reaction was to ring the Minister of the Interior whilst I was still on my way, to inform him of the disaster.
From the outdoor pool of the Imperial, the gunman moved to the spa area where he shot more people. Then he went on into the hotel itself.
People in the hotel were screaming. They couldn't see him. They just heard the sound of him shooting.
So who was this gunman? The man killing tourists on a beach. His name was Saifedean Rezgi. Within hours, the so-called Islamic State would produce this photo of him and claim him as their own. To find out more about the killer, who was only 23, I travelled inland from Sousse to Kirouan. It's one of the oldest Islamic centres in Tunisia. Rezgi was studying electrical engineering at the university here. I met Dr. Hedi, who runs the Science Institute.
These are his marks for the first year of his master's degree. As you can see, they were good. He didn't behave in any way to attract attention, or he was just a student like any other.
I also spoke to Imen Romdani, a fellow student.
We were all really shocked. It wasn't something we expected of him. They say he was very religious, but where's the beard that religious fanatics have? Where is the long shirt? Saif didn't have these kind of clothes.
To Imen, this was the man she knew, posting videos of himself on social media.
There's a video of Saif in a music club, so I can't imagine that he is so fanatical that he would kill people of a different religion.
Now, looking at the IS picture of Rezgi, she sees a different person.
It's true it's a photo of Saif, but he doesn't look himself. He seems afraid of something.
Others at the university who knew Rezgi can understand what causes some young Tunisians to become radicalized.
Rezgi was one of the activists among the Islamic youth at the university, but he wasn't one of the leaders. He was amongst the second-ranking members. Young Tunisians who are drawn to these hotspots, who join these terrorist groups and choose this lifestyle, are all suffering from social pressures and poverty. These are the main causes that lead young people in the direction of jihad, or so-called jihad.
Seyfeddin Rezgi's personal jihad was just about to change more British lives inside the Imperial Hotel. 24 tourists, including the Callahans and the Richards, ran to some offices on the first floor. They thought it would be safe. It would prove to be anything but.
We carried on running down to the corridor and we came to a dead end.
With a window at the bottom?
Yeah, there was a window at the bottom and Tom looked out of it and said, we'll have to jump out of here, but the drop must have been about 30 feet.
Tony urged everyone to hide in rooms along the corridor.
I shouted to him, we can't stay here. You've got to try and find some cover. Don't just, you know, be sitting ducks. Try and just get into some offices and hide.
I kept Tony in view. I just went with the flow. I didn't look back.
Then the gunman appeared in the corridor.
As we turned around, I heard two shots fired. As people parted ways, I saw two people had been shot right at the bottom of the corridor. And there was just one gunman stood right at the end of the corridor opposite me. Everything slowed down, like a horror movie, like the bad guy being at the end of the corridor.
There was panic.
Everyone were trying to get into the nearest door. And as all this happened, he must have thrown a grenade and also shot in my direction. It landed about a metre and a half, 2 metres in front of me.
I felt the shrapnel hit the back of my leg. And then at that point, that's when Thomas fell to the floor and said, I've been hit.
I remember watching it. It was like in slow motion. And I got blown back by the blast of the grenade.
It was just sheer panic. It just happened so quickly. And I just thought, at that point, I thought, we're not even going to survive. He's going to come down the corridor.
Tom and Sam locked themselves in a bathroom. Tony and Chris were still in the gunman's path.
I felt a bullet hit my left calf as I was running, and Chris was right behind me, and I knew she was behind me because we were running together. Just turned to this little alcove, and the chap in front of me, with another guy, had burst open the door because it was locked, and we all sort of dived into that office.
They barricaded themselves in. Tony thought Chris was right behind him.
I looked round and Chris wasn't with me. For that moment, I just thought, I said, shout out, my wife's not with me, where is she? And I said, let me back out. And the chap says, you know, we can't go back out. You know, what if the gunman's there?
And when you realised that you were on one side of the door and Tony was on the other?
Oh, I was so frightened. I just wanted Tony. I was so frightened.
I said, but my wife is out there. I said, you know, I need to be out there with her. And as I said that, I heard my wife shouting out, Tony, please help me, I've been shot. Sorry. I mean, that was the worst time for me because my wife was outside, helpless. I was inside relatively safe.
Chris blacked out. The gunman's bullets had shattered her right leg.
And then I woke up. I didn't know I'd been shot, didn't feel anything. I woke up in this alcove, propped up against a wall, with my leg laying across my tummy. And I couldn't comprehend. It was surreal. And I looked round and I saw this lady on her front. And she kept saying, help me, I'm going to die. I'm going to bleed to death. I says, no, you're not, you know, and I reached out and touched her shoulder.
The gunman moved on, leaving more dead and wounded behind him.
During all this time, there was a lady who was, she was badly injured from the grenade in the corridor, and all's like you can hear, I still hear now is, help me, I'm dying. And, you know, we, at the end of the day, we were just too scared to come out. And, you know, that's still upsetting for me now, because I couldn't go and help her, because I was too frightened to go out there.
Outside, the hotel owner was briefed by her staff.
As soon as we arrived at the hotel, the security guards would not allow me to go into the hotel because they were frightened that I might be targeted. The terrorist was mad. It was like a robot shooting everywhere.
C'était comme un robot qui tirait de partout.
It's 6 minutes past 12, 28 minutes into Rezgi's attack. He's now heading out of the hotel, past the pool, back towards the beach. Ayman, the Tunisian tourist, gets close enough to film what happens next. For the first time, Rezgi faces armed opposition. Not from state security forces, but from that young Tunisian who'd taken the policeman's assault rifle. He is wearing red shorts.
He fired the first bullet and then the second one. Both hit a palm tree. After that, the gun jammed. The terrorist at that moment had a grenade in his hand and threw it.
You can see and hear this moment in Ayman's video. First, the shots fired by the young man in red shorts. Then Rezgi throws a grenade.
Shoot.
عنده قنابل صوتية هذا.
واخذ جد، واخذ جد.
أوه، إيش 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 إيش.
They can now see Rezgi, just a few yards in front of them. The gun the man in red shorts had taken from the policeman was now useless. Like the others, he had to get away from Rezgi.
The guy with the police weapon shot twice and then ran away. The gun didn't fire anymore.
Immediately after the attack, some tourists said they'd seen a man in red shorts with a gun. It gave rise to the theory there was a second killer. But Ayman's video, together with the eyewitnesses, mean there's little doubt the so-called second gunman was in fact the Tunisian in red shorts. The interior minister had been alerted right at the start of the attack. Yet half an hour into it, Ayman's video shows no sign of security forces. That's extraordinary, given what happened in Tunisia just 4 months earlier. Another attack, again on visitors, at the Bardo Museum in the capital, Tunis. IS gunmen killed 21 foreign tourists, one of them British. The Tunisian Prime Minister promised tighter security, but it didn't materialize.
There was, I think, a major denial from Tunisian authorities to say, look, we've been attacked, it's just a blip. This is just once in a lifetime and we'll go on with our lives.
Some European tour operators reacted to the museum attack by selling far fewer Tunisian holidays. That didn't happen in Britain to the same extent. Some companies offered cheap deals.
The warnings were there. If you get a week all-inclusive for £400 in a five-star resort, it means that there's something wrong. And the something wrong is that there was a security risk in that country.
Just a month before the Sousse attack, the so-called Islamic State tweeted a chilling message. They warned Christians planning summer holidays don't come to Tunisia, as they were planning something even bigger than the museum attack. Then came a final warning.
This is a tweet from the early hours of the morning of the attack. It says, "Our lone wolves are not like other wolves. They are soldiers of the Caliphate, and this is just the beginning of terror, O infidels. Specifically, Tunisia, hashtag Sousse conquest." Now, it's believed that this tweet was posted by Rezgi himself. So with such explicit warnings from IS, should foreign tourists have been here at all? At the resort in Sousse, Rezgi's now been on the rampage for about half an hour. A second Tunisian, Ayman, is preparing to stop him. He's following Rezgi back to the beach from the hotel.
When I saw he was small and thin, I realised I could hit him even if he was armed.
Ayman sensed an opportunity.
He came there and he put down the weapon, the Kalashnikov. I was happy as he put the weapon down. I could attack him.
But the only thing to hand, bottles of olive oil.
Then he prepared a grenade and picked up his Kalashnikov again and headed out.
Ayman realized it would be futile to attack, but continued to stalk the gunman. Rezgi now seemed to enter a new phase of his mission.
At that moment, he wasn't shooting or killing people. He was walking as if he was happy. He had his head held high.
On the beach, Ayman can't believe what he's seeing. So many dead and injured, and still no sign of police or paramedics. It's now that Rezgi decides to get rid of his phone. It's believed he'd used it earlier to make a 10-second call just before the start of the attack.
He was coming from over there. I was close to him, something like 20 metres away. He was walking, holding the Kalashnikov and the bomb. He took his mobile out and threw it in the sea.
As two Coast Guard boats speed by, Ayman shouts that Rezgi has thrown something into the sea. Thanks to him, the phone's later recovered with its potentially crucial information. As the gunman moves along the beach, Tunisians form a human chain to stop him going into the neighbouring Bellevue Hotel, where tourists are hiding. Ayman is overwhelmed by what Rezgi has done. Meddi, who'd seen the whole attack from the start, was now close enough to actually talk to Rezgi.
He asked me, "Why are you here?" I said to him, "You have destroyed my livelihood and shed the blood of all these people. And you ask me, why are you here?"
The massacre on the beach shocked Tunisians. But Rezgi's fanaticism didn't come out of nowhere. It was unleashed in the wake of the Arab Spring 4 years ago. Tunisia's popular revolution was the first to overthrow an authoritarian regime. Rezgi lived in Kirouan. I visited the Grand Mosque here to speak to the Imam about the growth of Islamic extremism.
This phenomenon has come to us from abroad and is alien to Tunisia. We don't have in our culture, in our society, such people, religious fanatics. We call them Salafists.
Salafism is a fundamentalist interpretation of Islam. Violent extremists have emerged from within some Salafi groups.
There were sleeper cells, and as soon as the revolution came, they emerged. They wanted to impose themselves on us.
The Grand Mosque follows the different Islamic tradition of Tunisia. But since the Arab Spring, hundreds of Salafi mosques have taken root in the country, beyond the government's control. Rezgi attended this Salafi mosque in Kirouan.
The government has taken back control of mosques here in Kairouan and in Tunisia generally. There have been efforts to prevent extremism, but these security measures aren't enough. We still need to re-educate people.
In just the length of 2 years, you went from a very liberal modern Muslim society that was really a model for others to being the one that was the closest to now sending young men to fight jihad.
It's estimated nearly 5,000 young Tunisians have gone to fight for jihadist groups, more than from any other country, and many have come home.
Just the sheer numbers of jihadists inside the country that are going to go after Westerners or other targets is just mind-boggling.
Many of those jihadists belong to the so-called Islamic State. 6 months ago, this was their message to Tunisia. Rezgi, the engineering student, didn't spend all his time in class. He trained with IS in neighboring Libya, something the Tunisian government says it only discovered after the Sousse attack. Up to 20 young men have disappeared from Kirouan University alone. Six have been killed fighting abroad.
In my institute, we have six names, but there is more than six. More of six.
More than you don't know about.
The student union warned the government just a month before the Sousse attack about what some of its young men were up to.
We submitted a report on the numbers of students who have travelled to war zones such as Iraq, Syria, Libya, but the state didn't even bother to ask any questions.
Rezgi was not on that list, but his leaning towards radicalism had been noticed. The Tunisian government insists Rezgi wasn't known to their security services. But is that the case? We've discovered that 18 months ago, the house where he lived with other young men was raided by the police. It was witnessed by his neighbors.
At the time, the authorities were conducting a campaign against these people, Salafists and other jihadists. They carried out a surprise raid and searched his house, but it was during the holidays and they were away. The police didn't find anything.
Rezgi and his friends never came back. They moved to another part of town. We don't know whether there was any follow-up, but it's clear the country's security services were in disarray.
After the Arab Spring, sadly, the most competent people within the Ministry of Interior were fired after this, and they had the knowledge and the experience of dealing with terrorism.
With state security forces nowhere to be seen, it was left to ordinary Tunisians to hold the line and stop Rezgi killing more tourists. Inside the Imperial Hotel, people started helping the wounded. Tom Richards tended to a young woman.
She had a massive piece of shrapnel in her leg. I just basically said to her that I'm going to have to take this out if I'm going to stop the bleeding. So she said, OK, and I just pulled it out, and it was about an inch and a half tall. I pulled it out and then packed her leg with tissue paper and used my top to tie it round to try and stop the bleeding. And I did the same with my mum's leg.
At that point, I didn't even know if my youngest son was OK. We were just in sheer panic of what we're going to do.
Callum, her youngest son, was barricaded into a room on a floor above with another family.
Luckily, we had our mobiles with us, and the family rang me on my mobile and said, we've got Callum. So that was a relief.
Tony Callahan was still trapped inside an office with five others. His wife, Chris, lay badly wounded outside in the corridor.
I can't get out of my mind at the moment of not being able to help Chris, not being with Chris when she was actually shot. And I couldn't do anything about that. But that'll stick with me.
I was so frightened. I thought they were going to come and, you know, finish us off, really. I was so traumatised.
I feel guilty. I feel guilty I couldn't help her. But I couldn't do anything else. I couldn't jeopardise the other five people in that room.
Angela Evans had made it to the Bellevue Hotel. She will never forget that journey.
I had to go through these people. And this lady just said, please, no. She said, help me, please, help me.
Was she wounded?
And it wasn't like I thought, you know, bullet holes, you think it's going to be a hole, but they were like gouges out of her body. And I could only say, I'll be back, I'll come back. We just had to keep moving until we got to the next hotel.
Back on the beach, Mehdi and the others are still following Rezki. Then he starts to run. They're worried he'll get away.
I picked up two pots, ashtrays from the beach, and wanted to hit him with them.
Mehdi chases after the gunman as he heads off the beach. Becky and Mark, who'd been paragliding just before the attack, had already been helped off the beach by resort staff.
We all run out this little gate and onto the street, and then we all run up the street together.
Mark had to drag me all the way up because I was frozen, basically.
Frozen with fear?
Yeah, I didn't know what was going on. I couldn't run, I felt sick.
Shopkeepers came out to help the tourists. One of them, Ajmi Boubacar, looked after 35 people.
I see the people he come from beach. I said, what is problem? He told me, terrorist. Okay, you come here. Go inside, all people come inside here.
Keep quiet.
Every people stay.
Mark and Becky were captured on CCTV in another store as they tried to escape the gunman. Rezki was filmed running towards where they were hiding. On a roof above the street, a Tunisian builder, Mael Monsef, was watching everything.
I shouted, what are you doing? That this was contrary to Islam. What he was doing was wrong, that he was a terrorist. He raised his gun like this and fired, but his aim was off because he was tired. I recoiled at first, then I saw the tiles. I took them like this and threw them down on him.
Ayman, his camera still on, is running towards the street and hears gunfire.
I put my camera like this and I was filming. There was heavy gunfire.
Around 35 minutes after the attack started, a policeman finally fires at Rezki. He falls to the ground.
I was throwing down the second lot when my neighbour started shouting, stop, he's fallen.
Then he stood up again. After that, he started shooting at police. There were so many policemen there. There was lots of shooting, bullets everywhere.
It was all happening right outside the shop, where Mark and Becky were hiding.
You could almost, like, feel it, like, behind us. You could literally, you know, hear ricochets and all sorts going on behind us.
We were just hoping that we'd get through it together and that we'd see people again, see our family again, and that we'd get home safe.
Rezgi was now cornered.
These were the last meters he walked.
The police had finally shot him dead. It was 12:16, 38 minutes after the attack started. But the bullets kept coming.
The police were firing because he still had a bomb. I was telling them maybe he has an explosive belt.
Mehdi also witnessed the end of the Sousse attack. He still had the pots in his hands.
I realised he'd been shot and killed. I collapsed on the ground, then suddenly remembered the people on the beach. So I went to help them.
I was disappointed because I hoped they wouldn't kill him, but arrest him alive and hold him accountable and find out his motive for killing those people.
The tourists hunkered down in their hotels, didn't dare to come out. They didn't know if the gunman was dead or if there were others.
I just didn't know if I was ever going to get home. I didn't know if I was going to get out of the room. And if there was a lot of these murderers.
In the Imperial, Tony and others hiding along that corridor eventually felt safe to come out.
Tony appeared from this room he was in. He said, oh, my God, you know, and he hugged me. And I don't remember much after that, really. I was awake, you know. I wasn't in pain at all. It must have been the shock.
Well, as soon as I saw her, I mean, I was absolutely overwhelmed by what I saw. It was an appalling sight to see Chris's leg, you know, 90 degrees across her body.
Chris and Tony were amongst the lucky ones who survived.
There's a young man who was holding a lady's hand. He says, I don't know what to do. I think she's dead. I tried to check for a pulse. I said, I'm so sorry. I said, you know, I think she's passed away. He just said, I just don't know what to do. They'd only just got engaged recently. And she was such a beautiful looking girl, absolutely beautiful, and lay there so calm and peaceful. And I just felt so sorry for both of them.
Sam and Tom finally felt safe to leave their hiding place.
Right at the end of the corridor, there was two dead bodies, and we had to, like, walk up around them to get out.
You don't normally see things like this, but just the poor people in that corridor, it's just, you know, that'll take a long time to be able to come to terms with a lot of that happened there.
It was total chaos. Total chaos. People didn't know who had died, who was injured, neither the tourists, nor the Tunisians, nor the hotel staff. There were moments of fear seeing the bodies, seeing this terrible massacre.
À la vue de ces corps, à la vue de ce terrible massacre.
It was left to Tunisians on the beach to comfort the injured in the immediate aftermath of the attack. and beach workers and shopkeepers who protected countless holidaymakers that day.
Thank you to the guy that saved our lives and protecting us with his own life, because if he'd have let us carry on, we wouldn't have made it.
But 38 people had been murdered by Rezgi in the same number of minutes. Would there have been so many British tourists in Sousse if they'd known there had been several warnings of the terror to come? Most people know about the museum shooting, but there was another attack 18 months earlier, and it was right here in Sousse.
A suicide bomber from the same group that would spawn Seyfeddin Rezgi blew himself up when he tried to get into a tourist hotel. He killed himself, but no one else. And this was literally just a few miles down this beach. The question is, were the British holidaymakers aware of that?
Did you know about that?
No. No.
Would that have affected your decision to go, do you think, if you'd known?
Yes, I think it would. Yes, I think it would. I'm not brave.
Do you think you would have gone on holiday had you known that, to Tunisia?
Yeah, because there's been terrorist attacks in the UK and people still go to London. It could happen anywhere, at any time, at any location, and, you know, you're never truly safe anywhere.
The Foreign Office gives safety advice to travellers on its website. The explosion on the beach at Sousse in 2013 was on it, as was the Bardo Museum attack. But tourists weren't advised to stop going to Tunisian beach resorts.
The no-go areas were on the Libyan border, so that was nowhere where we were going to be. If I have any doubts, we certainly wouldn't have gone if we'd had any doubts at all.
What happened here raises questions for all of us. Where is safe these days? Can we realistically expect guarantees? Or must we now accept that there's a real risk in travelling to countries in Africa and the Middle East, countries which are increasingly vulnerable to terrorism?
Ultimately, we decide where to travel based on confidence the country we're going to can look after us. But there were no armed guards stationed outside Sousse hotels before the attack in June, despite the mounting threat of terror.
Normally, when we've been on holiday before and a hotel backs onto a beach, there's a hut with a security man or an armed police standing there, making sure that, you know, everybody's safe. And that's one thing that wasn't present in Tunisia at this hotel.
We would obviously have liked armed police to be here instantly to shoot him down the second it happened. But no one thought it would happen, and it could happen anywhere in the world.
There were plenty of heavily armed forces when the Home Secretary, Theresa May, visited Sousse 3 days after the attack. With her, a team of British investigators who concluded another terror attack was highly likely. Tourists were then advised to stay away. The Foreign Office says more work needs to be done to protect holidaymakers.
You have a country which is not yet convinced of the terrorism problem, but also disorganized police, Ministry of Interior in shambles. Unfortunately, it's going to take time for the Tunisian authorities to rebuild their security apparatus.
Now there are armed guards outside the Imperial Hotel and frequent patrols on the beach in the street where Rezgi was killed. Tunisia's government has declared a state of emergency because of the terror threat. It's also been used to silence those who speak out about security lapses.
And are you worried that when you talk about the police's failure to do anything, this may create difficulties for you?
I can imagine that 1,000%. The guy in the red shorts who took the gun from the policeman got a phone call from them. They threatened him, told him not to talk about it.
We asked the Tunisian government about the police response to the attack, about the earlier raid on Rezgi's house, but we received no answer. Despite the bravery of many Tunisians who saved lives that day, their tourist industry is now in ruins.
People would say, we're not going to be beaten by these terrorists and we will go. And I've said that many a time in the past. You know, we'll do what we'll do. But my goodness, when you're involved in an incident like we've been involved with, that changes your mind. That really does, that focus things.
If you stop going to the country that is basically funded on tourism, the country's just going to die in it itself, the country's going to collapse. So with us not going, it's, in effect, we are part of killing that country.
Here, I need to get money. Where I'm going to get money? I just work in tourism. What I'm going to do now?
The Sousse attack has been devastating for all those caught up in it, Tunisians and British alike. For Chris and Tony, who survived the terror on the beach, there are difficult months ahead. Chris has endured three operations already and needs another one.
Her injuries are life-changing, and we've got now to live with that. But we take positives out of the negative. We're positive that we're here, we see our family, grandchildren. We've got a life, we've got each other.
Sometimes you see it just sat there in the middle of the day thinking about it.
It was terrific, like a war zone. It's something that keeps continuously going over and playing, you know, over and over in my mind all the time. And how, you know, we didn't die in that corridor. It's unbelievable.
I went to church. I went to look for answers. You know, those poor people who didn't even have time to say, well, please help. They didn't have that time. So I didn't get answers, but I realised that I was there to ask for them to be looked after.
38 dead, 39 injured, despite the warnings for 2 years about the danger here. Not just British, German, Belgian, Portuguese and Russian too. The oldest British victim was 80, the youngest just 19. 9 people lost their partner, and in one family, 3 men never came home. And all they did was go on holiday.
More details of organisations that offer advice and support, go online to the BBC ActionLine website or call to hear recorded information on 08000 565 450. Lines are open 24 hours and calls are free from landlines and mobiles.